The next topic in science that we need to talk about is a theory. And you'll notice that I don't have a step number next to this, and this is because a theory is not step seven in the scientific method. A theory is a scientifically accepted principle that's supported by a large body of evidence, and it comes from testing many, many different hypotheses. These are much more general ideas, and not every hypothesis leads to a theory. So let's look at a couple examples. The cell theory. The cell theory is very simple. It just says all living things are made of cells. And you can imagine many, many different hypothesis tests where you could find a new living thing and examine is it in fact made of cells, or find something that is not living and see that it's not made of cells. The theory of evolution by natural selection, that will be one of our next topics. And again, this is a theory. It's an accepted principle based on a large body of evidence. And we will talk about some of that evidence coming up. There's often a lot of confusion around the word theory, and this comes from the fact that our common use of the word theory and the scientific meaning of the word theory are different. So when we use the word in common language, the theory is just a guess. So you might have, my theory is that the Giants are going to do well this season in baseball. That's just a guess. I don't have any particular knowledge in baseball other than being a fan. And that's something we use in everyday language. This is really more like a hypothesis, right? You're making a guess based on your previous experience or knowledge, but it's not based on any data yet. The scientific meaning of a theory is the best testable explanation that's got a lot of data behind it. And so one of my pet peeves is when someone says, "Oh, well, that's just a theory." Well, something can't just be a theory because, by definition, if it is a scientific theory, it has lots of data, to support that particular explanation of what we're seeing in the natural world. Another concern people sometimes bring up about science, or an issue they think of with science, is that it's not creative. That you have art and music, and that's creative, and science could basically be done by robots because it's doesn't have any room for creativity. And that's actually not the case at all. There's a lot of creativity in how we make observations. Different people can look at a plate of bacteria or a microscope slide or a group of geese and see very different things. And so there's a lot of creativity there. There's creativity in forming hypotheses. Are there different possible explanations to something you're seeing? Designing experiments. There's a lot of creativity in designing experiments, and I think some of the best biologists of the 20th century are the people who figured out novel ways to answer questions and design interesting experiments. And then even interpreting the data, taking a data set that everyone sees in one way and looking at it from a different view can really be important to moving science forward. We also want to remember what the limitations of science are, and we sort of talked about this at the very beginning of this lecture. Science is not absolute proof. One of the tenets of the scientific method is that you can support a hypothesis or you can disprove it, but you cannot absolutely prove it. And to give you the reason for this, let me give you a quick example. Let's say I have the hypothesis that all swans are white. And I spend the next 50 years writing down the color of every swan I see, and I see a million swans, and they're all white, and I continue to support my hypothesis. That's great. Then I'm 99, I get off an airplane in Russia, and I see a black swan. That one black swan has refuted my hypothesis, even though I have a million data points that say swans are white. So scientists feel like we can never absolutely say that we've gotten every piece of data. So you will hear scientists say, to the best of our knowledge, to the best of our understanding, the data suggests that this is what's happening. They're not saying that because they don't know what they're doing. They're saying it because the scientific method says we cannot absolutely prove things. The only people who get to prove things are physicists, and that's because they have laws. Biology, we have theories, lots of data to support those. Laws are something you can actually write mathematical formulas for, and we just don't have those in biology, and so we can't have absolute proof. Anecdotal observations, stories about things. I saw a bear eat a blueberry once. That is an interesting observation. It can be the starting point of science, but it is not the end point. It is not the results or the conclusions of science. Data that's false. That could be accidental because you measured something wrong. It can also be manipulated. Scientists are human beings, and some lie and put false information for ego reasons or monetary gain. And generally, that is fixed or caught by the public nature of science. But data that is false is not scientific. Science is not the truth. There are people who seem to make science their religion, and that's not the point here. The point, again, is to understand the natural world. And so in this class, we will learn a ton about the different components of life and how they work, but we will not be covering the meaning of life. You're going to have to go to your English and psychology and philosophy classes to learn that part. So again, remember, we're sticking to how do we explain and understand the natural world, and how do we help solve problems. And that's the scientific method.